Hello, this is Pastor A.R. Bernard. To our CCC family, our friends, members, partners, supporters, locally and around the world, we welcome you to a new format. The world is changing, and thank God for technology, we can still have a Sunday worship experience with you, but with limited participation from our staff. I'm here joined by Pastor Jamaal Bernard. PJ, good to have you with us. Can we fist bump?
Yes, that's all we can do, really.
We gotta maintain the spaces between us. But we welcome you. And again, this is a rapidly changing time that we're in, and we adjust as we can. We're thankful for all of our staff members who sacrifice to make all of this happen very quickly. So we're gonna open with a inspirational song from our own Kim Harley.
Praise the Lord, Christian Cultural Center. We want to welcome you to our praise and worship experience. So feel free to clap your hands with us. Feel free to stand up where you are. If you're tuning in, let's declare that this is God's day. Come on, say, shout for glory, shout for praise. Do you have the victory today? Shout for victory and rejoice in the Lord. For this is the day that he's made. Come on, shout for glory, shout for praise, shout for the victory, and rejoice in the Lord. Yes, come on and say yes. In yours, I am victorious. See, yes, I've been redeemed. Say yes, I'm an overcomer through his power that lives in me. Shout for glory, you know it by now, come on and sing it. Shout for the victory and rejoice in the Lord. Shout for glory, shout for praise. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Yes, and rejoice in the Lord, for this is the day. Come on and sing.
I will rejoice.
Now you say it. Come on, encourage yourself today. Through the storm and the rain, I will rejoice. Oh yes, I will rejoice. In spite of what it looks like today, in the face of all uncertainty, I will rejoice. Rejoice. One more time, let's sing it. I will rejoice. No matter how it looks, no matter how I may feel, I stand on your word. Yes, I will. Come on, say hallelujah. 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 We bless your name.
Wow, welcome back, and thank you, Kim, for such an inspirational song at a time like this. It was amazing. Thank you again. Dr. Bernard, last week you posted a video, well, we posted a video online responding to the coronavirus, and it went viral on our website, and I got a couple of questions. Well, I want to read a couple of lines and ask you a question pertaining to this.
Okay, good.
So it reads that many are becoming overwhelmed by the tension, fear, and anxiety created by all the confusion and uncertainty surrounding the coronavirus. From the nature of the virus, the incubation period, how it is transmitted, the rapid spread of the virus, the challenges to containing it, the lack of testing kits, to the impact on the economy and our way of life. It is easy to find ourselves or yourself filled with feelings of despair. How do we respond to the fear and the worry?
Wow, and that is one of the key questions, because fear is a natural response, God-given response to protect us, but it can be taken too far and torment us and paralyze us. Fear is a natural response to feelings of threat and anxiety that comes if there's something challenging us that we feel that we're not in control of. Mm. And when I think about that, I think about two words versus each other, worry versus concern.
Okay.
And I think that worry has associated with it negative connotations. It serves feelings of fear and anxiety, and it leaves us unproductive. When we worry, we tend to feel, okay, there's nothing I can do. So we feel distressed, right? But concern is where we say, okay, there's an issue that we have to face. I have to now be stirred with innovation and creativity, and I'm asking, what can we do about it? So worry is unproductive. Mm-hmm. Concern leads to productivity,
That's good.
Productive thought. And I think if we place ourselves where God wants us, it's in a place of concern, but not worry. Mm. And worry is a substitute for prayer anyway.
That's a message right there.
Amen. I think we're going to get a lot of messages out of this conversation.
But but what's the interruption? Is it the way of life? Is it where is the biggest concern of the interruption? Because from what I see when I look at social media and things like that, people are upset that it's interrupting their way of life.
I know, and some people are ignoring the interruption because we see on the news young people, God bless them, with their invincibility, but they're down on the beaches in Florida, in California, and they are clustered. And celebrating spring break and whatnot, acting as though, you know, it's going to be okay. If it happens, it happens. And what we're finding now in the reports that were given to us by the government, 29% of coronavirus cases are aged 20 to 44.
Wow.
So this is hitting our young people. They're getting sick. You know, they're recovering for the most part because the elderly are most likely to be threatened 50-50% with sickness and death. And that's a tough thing. But our young people have to realize that they have to exercise discretion, responsibility, social distancing. Mm-hmm. And I love all of these new words that enter our language when these situations come about. But let me ask you, you are in a position now where you're overseeing a lot of the operations and programming for Christian Cultural Center, our several campuses. You know, pastors have been calling you. Mm-hmm. We've talked about that. So first, let's ask the question to you is, what have you gotten out of this crisis immediately?
One of the two major things I got out of this crisis is, one, the frailty of life, how frail we as humans are. And the need for, you know, the Savior. Not to, you know, get too preachy, but I'm pastors. I can preach, you know, the need for the Savior, Jesus Christ. But then the ability to be creative. It's an amazing, you know, I'm on social media, Instagram, Facebook, and you see the creativity that people are having and talking about the concern, but doing it in a way that is not as heavy as a burden. But just having that dialogue and that conversation, so the creativity is amazing, but it just shows how frail we are as humans and the things that God has put in place to, I would say, to have us at a need for Him.
All right, so you're on social media, mm-hmm. so you kind of keep up with all of that, which is very, very important because that's part of life now. Do you find that people are creating a degree of levity around it, but respectfully and sensitively so, but at the same time, are they looking for hope? Are they looking for encouragement? Are they looking for something stable that they can hold on to?
Yes, and that's the thing. So when you look at it, yes, there's some levity behind it. So the two things that are tended to either trend or move to the top of the likes or the shares are either the funny aspect, the humor behind either whether life or the coronavirus, and the hope dealing that Christians are starting to do over social media, whether quoting scriptures, praying, posting little statements pertaining to faith and fear or worry and concern, like you were saying earlier. So you're starting to see the two trends, and that's where you can really get a sense of where people are as things trend within social media.
Now, I got a call from pastors from around the country. I got text messages and emails from pastors around the world. And pastors are basically looking for best practices. What are you doing? What are you guys doing? How you handle this?
Yes.
You got some of those calls.
Yes.
What were some of the questions that the pastors were asking you?
One, what are you guys doing? That was the first question. I'm not sure if they were seeing if we were going to revolt and say, no, we're going to have our services and we're going to band together and revolt. Or the other end of the side to say, okay, how are you guys going to handle it? And what's going to be the best practice going forward? What do you see now, currently, and what do you see into the future? So they were relying on, they couldn't get in touch with you, so a lot of them were calling me because we have a relationship.
Well, I'm glad they called me.
What's your father doing? What are you guys doing? So that was a big question. That was one of the first questions they would ask when I got on the phone.
I think that's important because it shows that we can't build these silos and these isolated kingdoms as churches and ministries, that we need each other.
Yeah, and it was a question of let's link arms. Okay, what are you doing and how can we link arms and come along as well? So it wasn't just like a cry for help, but help and what can we do together?
It's interesting because you also said how some were wondering, do we revolt against mm-hmm. protocol and
yep.
the government imposing themselves and we're going to have church anyway, mm-hmm. Which is dangerous.
Yes.
Because not only do we have a responsibility to preach the gospel, to represent Jesus, to speak into the lives of our people, but we also have a responsibility to protect them and to be concerned about their safety and their security. And following protocols is part of that concern. I mean, it was tough. You and I talked and deliberated, and what are we going to do? Are we going to not have service? What will the people say? Mm-hmm. Will people get comfortable watching from online and on all social media platforms? I think with that, people are going to miss being able to come together.
I agree.
And I think there's going to be that hunger to restore connections that were removed or suspended because of what we're going through. So, we had service and we had our choir and had less than 500, which at mm-hmm. that time was the number given by the governor here in the state of New York. And those numbers changed so rapidly, now we're down to 10. So we really couldn't have an audience. So we decided to be, like you said, innovative and creative at this time and come up with this format where we have a conversation. And we'll go through some things later in the program that, will minister to our people. And those of you out there, CCC members and family, we hope that you continue to pray and participate in this because we're going to have some exclusive stuff for you only for
yes.
tuning in. And the services are going to be broadcast at 8 a.m. and 10:30 a.m. on Sundays and 7:30 p.m. on Tuesday evening. So we want to stay connected. I got a call from Cece Winans,
yes.
and Cece, her and her husband Alvin are pastoring a church down in Nashville, and she said to me that, she was just weeping because she was deeply moved by what's happening and the pain that people are in. But she saw it as an opportunity, and she
yes.
said God spoke to her and said, wow, we should be proactively using all of our social media platforms to speak life,
yeah.
God's love,
and
God's
hope.
Life, and God's life and hope
mm-hmm.
to the world. And I said, wow, that's great.
Yep.
Just because we're practicing, self-isolation or mandatory isolation, technology allows us to stay connected.
Yep.
So we can now use our social media platforms to preach the gospel. And I don't mean fire and brimstone. This is the judgment of God. Cut that. We're talking about God giving hope.
Yes. Yes.
Love, life, and light being poured out into the society to give people a sense of a future, that mm-hmm. things are going to change.
And it's the ironic thing is, who would have ever thought that we would have had to think about some ideas on how to use social media as a personal evangelism tool? But now it's challenging the Christians, say, look, let's evangelize, let's get out there and deal some hope to these individuals.
You know, I'm just looking at my notes here because this is Lent for us.
Yes.
And Lent is a time of prayer. It is a time of sacrifice or fasting. It is also a time of almsgiving, which is acts of charity. And what better time to engage carefully in acts of charity?
Yeah.
Because the church is the largest organized humanitarian agency in the world. We mobilize volunteers, we get people going. So even though we're not having services, our food pantry has been open. And we partnered with restaurants who had food left over and didn't want it to go to waste. So they called us and we worked together
yep.
to actually bring food, prepackaged food, and delivered food to some of our seniors
yes.
who can't get out,
shouldn't get out.
Mm-hmm. Right? And shouldn't get out. Yeah. And we're careful, wearing gloves and masks, mm-hmm. and just dropping it at the door, ringing the bell, and leaving. And I think we have some photos to show you of that going on. And also, while these photos are up, the sacrifice.
Yes.
Because we have Minister Dario there with his mm-hmm. family, his
yeah.
children.
My kids.
You have your children, my grandchildren that mm-hmm. are there, and we're saying, no, we're going to be on the front line trying to be as careful as possible.
Yep.
So this does not interrupt Lent.
No.
It really complements Lent.
It actually does. It forces individuals to rethink their Lent process. Like my daughter, mm-hmm. she gave up meat for Lent, and supermarket shelves are empty, looking for fish to eat, and you know, and she's like, okay, what do I do? I said, well, God that's gonna crucify you because you had to make some adjustments to your Lent because you gave him a promise at one stage, and then now you're at another stage or another experience in life. And so, okay, well, God, you know, I gotta make some adjustments to this. But, you know, ultimately, as you go through this process, you say, okay, Lord, you have that conversation with God. And I told her, I said, you're gonna be good. If you happen to have meat today, it's okay. It's all right. Legalistic, we're not going to go that far.
Yeah.
God understands. And
yeah.
some people are so legalistic that it's hurting their Lent experience.
That's very, very important, what you said there, legalism.
Mm-hmm.
Because a very dear friend of mine, he wrote a book about the Sabbath and practicing mm-hmm. the Sabbath. He's Jewish. And in the book, he has a chapter 13, and he talks about the Sabbath as a principle
mm-hmm.
as opposed to a law. Even though it's called the law of the Sabbath, they were legally bound to it. But he talked about when there are times of crisis that in order to practice that Sabbath, they had to make adjustments to it. And God's not going to come down and zap you or kill you. And so it is with our Lent experience.
Yes.
We have
mm-hmm.
to make adjustments because of the realities of what's going on. There's an incredible passage in the book of Amos, chapter 3, verses 8 through 9, in the New Living Translation. It reads as follows. The lion has roared.
Mm.
Who isn't frightened? The sovereign Lord has spoken. Who can refuse to proclaim his message at a time like this?
Yes.
Isn't that amazing?
Yes.
That really applies. And yes, this roaring lion of the coronavirus mm-hmm. scares us all. But the scripture says it's also an opportunity for the prophets of God, the spokespersons of God, to open their mouths with words of hope and words of a future, and that this is going to pass and we're going to come out of this okay. I think that's so important. Hey, it's been great.
Thank you.
Yes. I like this. So
I appreciate this.
We're going to now transition to a CCC news piece, some announcements, and then we'll be back.
The story of Ty Brown is actually three stories: success, rebirth, and crushing despair. Brown grew up in Crown Heights, Brooklyn, near the rough-and-tumble Albany Projects. Many of his friends joined gangs. He chose another path.
Being around gangs, being around violence, being around drugs and alcohol and within the family, instead of it teaching me what to do, it taught me what not to do.
Brown credits his early success to his involvement in an after-school program that included a marching band.
I was very attracted to structure, and marching band provides amazing structure.
When he got the chance, he created his own marching band, the Brooklyn Steppers. The band enjoyed incredible success, but financial support ended in 2009. That's when he entered a very dark period.
What did you do during it?
Nothing. Dark, like, it's light outside, I didn't want to go outside. Didn't take care of my grooming, barely showered. Ate all day, gained crazy weight.
For 2 years, and for the sake of his young son, he actually pretended to go to work before returning home to hide. He says his faith and his Christian Cultural Center family saved him.
On the rebuilding, I had to recognize that there's no way that the rebuilding would be so strong, so smooth, and so in love without God being there.
Success with a new marching band called Brooklyn United led him to even greater heights, major sponsorships, and financial success. He didn't know it at the time, but one person in particular was watching, Pastor A.R. Bernard.
People who walk the walk, live a certain way, to be somewhat of an example of what great Christians can do.
Brown now runs a program very much like the one he attended as a kid. And he owns a restaurant, which provides jobs and food for those down on their luck.
I'm grateful for the hardships that then became amazing lessons throughout the years, because as I'm speaking to people, I'm able to be very genuine about what I think can help them move from where they are to where they want to be through God's grace. And I can use my personal life as an example.
His love for his spiritual father, Pastor Bernard, continues to inspire him.
My gratefulness for God's selection over his life to lead us, to lead this flock of people, and hope that him knowing that just his presence alone can have this effect makes him one of the richest men we have walking the earth.
Frank Cipolla, CCC News.
Grace and Peace Christian Cultural Center. I am Cameron Bernard, and as you all can see, I am bringing the highlights to you from the comfort of my living room. Yup, family, it's official. Until further notice, you, our internet campus, is our primary campus for CCC. As we continue to exercise wisdom during this time in society, in accordance with the direction from our elected officials, all services and activities at our Brooklyn, Long Island, and Orlando campuses are suspended. However, that doesn't stop us from gathering together as believers right here from the comfort of our own homes to worship the Lord. Here's what I want you all to do. Depending on where you're viewing right now, via our website, Facebook, or YouTube, hit the share button, drop an emoji, and leave a comment. Let's continue to grow this community together. Now, some of us may have prayer requests. Don't even worry about it. All you have to do is just submit them right here in the comments section or send us a direct message. So many people have been impacted in many ways by this pandemic. James Girard sat down with Minister Aaron to discuss where are we and what can we do as believers. Take a look at their conversation and I'll be right back with you.
In a nutshell, we're forced to do community differently. Because even right now, we're engaging in community. Like we're in our, we want to share this conversation, on these different platforms, which is an area of community, but now it's just doing community differently.
Right. So, here we are, after having our first Sunday of worship being dwindled down to a 500 or less, that was an experience in and of itself. For us to be able to still appreciate how many of us initially had challenges with the new culture of social media and things of that nature, our golden saints and a lot of those in our community that eventually grew into embracing social media now can see where the blessing of social media remains. Had this happened in late 80s, early 90s, what would we have done? where would we be? You know, the church is the pillar of society. So now that we're still able to feed ourselves and reason one with another and get a word and a scripture that's going to carry us through the week, where other people are deficient and they're feeling lost, here we are giving God praise because we understand that this is indeed greater than us. And before the foundation of time, God knew this would happen. So where some people thought social media was the enemy and was evil, now we're seeing it work together for the good.
This is a perfect time for you too. If you're not already, connect with us on social media at cccinfo.org, CCC Long Island, and CCC underscore Orlando. Also, you can and you should subscribe to our YouTube channel. For more updates and information, visit our website at cccinfo.org. And remember, the testing of our faith produces perseverance. See you all next week.
What if there was an organization that existed solely to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ? What if the main goal was to help spiritual seekers become transformed believers? And what if they demonstrated the love and compassion of Christ to the world through humanitarian works and social engagements? But what if I told you that's our mission here at Christian Cultural Center? Because it is.
Welcome back. For those who are familiar with our Sunday service format, you know what time it is. It is offering time. And we have some thoughts that we would like to share with you. Dr. Bernard?
Yeah, I thought it important to not just go right into the video, which we usually do after the highlights, but to sensitize people to the fact that, yes, people are struggling, people are concerned about their jobs, and we have 130 employees at CCC who are also concerned about their livelihood. So we want to encourage you, our congregation, not to feel that, hey, this we can slack off in the area of giving. Mm-hmm. No, we really need your financial support at this time. And churches across the country and around the world are facing the same thing. The bills continue, healthcare payments, all the things that we have to deal with. So please be sensitive, and we encourage you to stay plugged in, not just with prayer and support and joining us through these programs, but also in your giving. And I want to thank you for those of you who are now transitioned to digital giving. You have no idea how it has cut down the time and effort necessary from our staff in order to process all of that. So thank you for coming into the 21st century. But we have now a video, wonderful expression and encouragement and inspiration and giving by our own Lori Field.
Today's Lenten prayer reminds us that God chooses us for greatness, not based on the externals people see, but based on the heart he sees. When God sends Samuel to anoint the king he has chosen from Jesse's sons, Samuel's immediately drawn to Eliab, the oldest and tallest. When it came to leadership, he looked the part. But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not consider his appearance or height, for I have rejected him." The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. God chose David despite his youth and despite his size. But there was still work for him to do, serving an angry and unstable boss, killing a giant no one else dared to face. Maybe someone can relate. David was destined for greatness, but getting there would require a sacrifice. God will call us to serve when we don't want to. God calls us to give when we don't think we have enough. God will call us to face a giant that might be legitimately terrifying. But if we remain faithful, we'll win. Because this is the work of the church. Remember, you can't beat God giving no matter how hard you try.
Let's enter into the joy of giving. If you're giving by check, please make it out to Christian Cultural Center. If you're giving by text, the number is 718-705-4336. Just include the dollar amount in your text and press send. If this is your first time giving by text, please fill out a one-time registration form to complete your gift. If you're giving online, you can click on the Donate tab. Thank you, and enjoy the rest of your worship experience.
Christian Cultural Center depends on the generosity of our members, friends, and partners in ministry to provide hope, encouragement, and growth to thousands in their faith journey. Every donation is greatly appreciated and treated with prayer for efficiency. Donating is easy. Here are two quick ways to do so. On your cell phone, text GIVE to 718-705-4336. You'll receive a link to donate right on your phone. Simply click the link, enter your information, dollar amount, and then submit, and you're done. The other easy way to give is to go onto our website, cccinfo.org/donate. Scroll down to the Give Now section, enter your information, your dollar amount, and then submit, and you're done. Thank you for your faithfulness in giving.
Praise the Lord. Through these difficult times that we are in, where we may not know all the answers, we may be uncertain, I want to encourage you today that your God, our God, is sovereign and He's holy. Come on and worship with me. Lord, you're holy. Lord, you're holy, and we lift you up and magnify your name. Have made and the awesomeness of you and how your love will never fade. Mere words cannot express what I feel inside. I can't describe your glory divine, but as a token of my love, this is what I'll do. I'll lift my hands and cry, holy. Lord, you are, yes, and we lift you up and magnify your name. Oh, you're holy. Thank you, Lord. Lord, you are, yes, and we lift you up and magnify your name. There's not enough words I can say to tell you how much I appreciate all the wonderful things you've given me. Your love and kindness, your tender mercy. It's my desire to praise you and tell you how much I love you. You're worthy of all of the honor. Lord, you're worthy of all the praise. I don't know why you love me, why you give me so much mercy. You did not have to suffer and die for me way back on Calvary, but I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for loving me, holding me, keeping me, and saving me. Thank you for your wonderful, glorious, holy and righteous, victorious, conqueror, triumphant and mighty, healer, deliverer, shield and defense. You're a strong tower, you're my best friend, omnipotent. Present soon coming King. You're Alpha Omega. You're Lord of everything. You're holy, Lord. Holy is your name. Lord, shield and defense, strong tower, you're my best friend, omnipotent, omnipresent, soon coming king, Alpha Maker, Lord of everything, holy, holy, holy is your name, oh Lord, you're holy, I've gotta cry holy, I yield myself before you, Lord, I humble myself before you, you're holy. You are just, you are true, you are our God, you are sovereign. Hallelujah. Oh, we bless you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, God.
Welcome back, family. And of course, we thank him for that incredibly inspirational song at a time like this. And it is God's holiness that sets him apart from everything and everyone else. So let me take you into some word right now. And I'm going to begin with a statement. God is good. And you say, right, all the time. And then I say, and all the time. And you say out there, God is good. And yet, God is good is a theological statement. Our theology is what we understand about God, about what it means to be human, and what it means to live in this world. And in times like these, our theology is critical because it gives us a perspective on what's happening around us. Our theology is a comprehensive way of seeing life that informs our words, our thoughts, our motives, our actions, and our attitudes, and especially our choices. And unfortunately, at times like this, when there's crisis in the world, when we're feeling it and experiencing it, in manifestations of anxiety and stress and worry and fear, we kind of go back to God, not saying he's good, but wondering, where is God? And if God is so powerful and God is so loving and, you know, all of that, why is he allowing all of this to happen to us? Where is God at times like these? And I want to let you know that from the time Jesus came to this earth as a baby, he was announced as Emmanuel, God with us, in a very unique and powerful way. And I'll have you know that God has not left us in 2,000 years, regardless of what we've gone through in human history. So God is still good, and God is, out of his goodness, very present. But when bad things happen, especially at this level, at this scale that many of us have never seen in our lifetime, what happens is God's character goes on trial. Yeah, God's character hits the witness stand. And we start to challenge God and ask him, well, why did this happen? Why are you letting this happen? And we kind of blame it on God. Well, the mystery of evil and misery and catastrophe is not about the character of God or his plans and purposes. It is the mystery of a fallen creation, at war with God and his goodness. Fallen humanity and powerful rebellious spiritual forces are at work against the goodness of God, trying to undermine it and change the image of God in the minds of human beings. Now, let's stop there for a moment. This conflict is so complex that it is difficult to discern the purpose behind every event or situation. So many forces are at work. We can't always make sense of the purpose behind everything that happens to us or happens in this world. This fallen humanity and these spiritual forces are using other humans and human institutions to accomplish evil and oppose the goodness of God. The love, life, and light that flows from the character of God. We can be easily blinded by the complexity of all of the circumstances and situations of evil that come our way and require a clear vision of God and His goodness. And this is why God came in the person of Jesus Christ. Let me take you through a few passages of Scripture to really run that home. One of them begins in the book of Psalms, Psalm 107, verse 20. And I'll start there because it was a prophecy talking about the coming of Jesus. Here it reads, and I'm reading from the Amplified Bible. He, God, sent His word and healed them and rescued them from their destruction. It speaks specifically to the nation of Israel, but again, is a prophetic announcement that God would come. The Word that was in the beginning with God, which was God, would eventually come, manifest in human form, and take on the issues that plague us here in human society. Let's go to another verse, Gospel of John, chapter 1, which I just somewhat quoted. Verse 1, John 1, 1. In the beginning, reading out of the Amplified Bible, in the beginning, before all time, was the Word, Christ, and the Word was with God. And the Word was God Himself. He was continually existing in the beginning, co-eternally with God. All things were made and came into existence through Him. And without Him, not even one thing was made that has come into being. In Him was life and the power to bestow life. And the life was the light of men. What a powerful scripture. But again, you know who it's talking about. It's talking about Jesus Christ. Let's go down to verse 14 in that same chapter 1 of the Gospel of John. And let's read it there. And the Word, which was in the beginning with God, the Word, Christ, became flesh and lived among us. And we actually saw His glory, the glory as belongs to the one and only begotten Son of the Father, the Son who is truly unique, the only one of His kind, who is full of grace and truth, absolutely free from deception. Wow. We're talking about a manifestation, not just of a person in a physical body, but the expression and manifestation of the very character and nature of God. Let's stay in that chapter and go down to verse 18. No one has seen God, His essence, His divine nature at any time. The one and only begotten God that is uniquely the Son, who is in the intimate presence of the Father, He has explained Him or revealed Him and interpreted and revealed the awesome wonder of the Father. Wow, again, Jesus becomes the full expression and revelation of the nature and character of the invisible, eternal, omnipotent God. So we turn to Jesus to understand the character and nature of God. And that's why people who don't know the scripture can misunderstand and misinterpret. Jesus Himself said, I'm not the thief. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. I am come that you might have life. This is our theology. This is what we understand about the nature and character of God. Another text we can look at while we're at it. Let's go to Matthew chapter 11, verse 27. Jesus speaking here, He says in verse 27, all things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one fully knows and accurately understands the Son except the Father. Do you hear that? No one knows, fully understands, or accurately understands the Son except the Father. And, the verse continues, no one fully knows and accurately understands the Father except the Son and anyone to whom the Son deliberately wills to reveal Him. So only Jesus knows the full essence of the Father. Only Jesus has experienced that full and clear vision of the Father. And only the Father knows the fullness of Jesus as His expression here on earth in human form. Notice the end of the verse, "And anyone to whom the Son deliberately wills to reveal Him." So we cannot know God in His essence unless there is a revelation. So without that revelation, it's easy for people to misjudge God, to misjudge His character, and to blame Him for evil, blame Him as the source of the things that create calamity, hardship, anxiety, etc. for us, especially in times like these. Let's go to another passage I'd like to look at, Colossians chapter 1. Verse 15, speaking of Jesus again, "He is the exact living image, the essential manifestation of the unseen God, the visible representation of the invisible, the firstborn, the preeminent one, the sovereign and the originator of all creation." Wow. "For by Him all things were created in heaven and on earth, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created and exist through Him. That is, by His activity and for Him." Amazing passages of Scripture that present Jesus as what we should think about when we think about God. So when you study the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and you study the life of Jesus, you are seeing God in revelation, God in action. Let me give you another verse, Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. Powerful verse, all right? In fact, let's go to verse 1. We'll start there. God, Hebrews 1, 1, "God, having spoken to the fathers long ago in the voices and writings of the prophets, in many separate revelations, each of which set forth a portion of the truth, and in many ways, has in these last days spoken to us in the person of one who is by His character and nature His Son, namely Jesus, whom He appointed heir and lawful owner of all things." Let's go to verse 3. "The Son, Jesus, is the radiance and only expression of the glory of our awesome God, reflecting God's Shekinah glory, the light being the brilliant light of the divine and the exact representation and perfect imprint of His Father's essence, and upholding and maintaining and propelling all things, the entire physical and spiritual universe, by His powerful word, carrying the universe along to its predetermined goal, when He Himself and no other had, by offering Himself on the cross as a sacrifice for sin, accomplished purification from sins and established our freedom from guilt. He then sat down, revealing His completed work at the right hand of the Majesty on high, revealing His divine authority, having become as much superior to angels since He has inherited a more excellent and glorious name than they." That is the Son of the living God, a name, Jesus, that is above all names. Notice, He, in Hebrews here, is the radiance of the Father, the exact image and character of God the Father, the invisible God that only the Son has seen, and He has now taken the time to reveal to us. This is so important. So we must not judge the character of God by what we see happening in the world around us. We must judge God by what we see revealed about Him in Jesus. Jesus' whole life and ministry on earth was about healing people, freeing them from evil and ministry, not bringing calamity. So your theology must not look at all of this going on and saying, where is God in the process? God is here, and He's here to heal, to deliver, to strengthen, to secure. But we are in a war. And those of you who were in my spiritual war class, you know what this conflict is all about. Fallen creation, fallen humanity, fallen spiritual forces, all at work to undermine and oppose the goodness of God. God is good. And if you're paying attention and you're walking by faith and not fear, you're going to see God's goodness during these stressful times. I want to have a word of prayer for you while we close. Lord, you called us to ultimately walk by faith and not by sight, to place faith over fear, prayer over worry, positive action over dreadful resignation, trust in you over human institutions and human governments. But you have also given us leaders as gifts, doctors and medicine as gifts, scientists and technology as gifts. So today, we put our hopes and trust in you, but we also thank you and pray for those gifts you've given to help us through these challenging times. Bless them, Father, in their work with innovation, creativity, wisdom, and endurance. We also choose personally to walk prudently, practicing wisdom and discretion in our interactions with people, friends, and family, practicing social distancing, but not social isolation. We abandon ourselves to your divine providence, your protection, direction, and even correction of this world that you love so much that you gave your only Son to die on a cross, but also rise from the grave. We take solace, Father, in these words throughout the Scriptures, and it came to pass, because everything comes to pass. And once it passes, we must pick up the pieces and become stronger as believers, stronger as the church universal, and stronger as humanity at large. We thank you, O Sovereign Lord, that you are still our refuge and strength, a very present help in troubled times. Amen and amen.
Wow, family, it is so true. Dr. Bernard, an amazing message. The importance of your theology right now in this season, in this time where we are as a people.
Yeah, you know, our theology informs our words, thoughts, mm-hmm. motives, actions, and attitudes, and choices, especially in response to times like this.
Yes.
And if your theological lens does not place things in proper perspective, you can end up, like I said, blaming God for mm-hmm. what's going on, especially if you're losing a loved one. If you're, you know, someone that you know is getting ill by all of this, you know, if you're losing a job, that's the question.
Yep.
And I think it's important that we put that in perspective.
That is so good. I also think about the people on the other extreme that have a theology that no weapon will touch us and whatnot, and not taking the proper precautions.
Yeah.
You know, faith is not illogical. Mm-hmm. Faith is logical, so there's a rational aspect behind it. So we need to use our brains as we practice our faith.
And that's the beauty of free will. Free will is the ability, the capacity mm-hmm. to deliberate over information and make judgments
yep.
as to whether it's good or evil, or our actions are going to respond accordingly.
Mm-hmm.
So that's part of free will, and that comes into play, especially now.
And that's why our theology is so important. Thank
Absolutely.
You so much for an
yeah.
amazing word.
Yeah, and thank you, all of our members, friends, partners, supporters locally and around the world for joining us. We hope and pray that this program, this experience today was a blessing to you. And we're going to continue to be innovative and creative to make sure that we stay connected as CCC family, our congregation, and with our broader family around the world, those of you that follow us. So again, join us Sundays, 8 a.m., 10:30 a.m.,
mm-hmm.
Tuesday evenings, 7:30 p.m., and I will announce this, I'm going to be doing a Bible study,
midweek
Bible study mm-hmm. on Wednesdays, that you'll be able to join me, and I'm going to take you through a wonderful trip. And we may even do that little spiritual warfare. Dig
don't
a little
tease
deeper.
Them.
You
don't
know?
Tease them.
Let me put that teaser out there.
Because some of them think we are spiritual warfare now.
We are,
mm-hmm.
and that's the reality.
Yep.
So again, thank you for tuning in. Thank you for PJ. It was
thank
great
you. Thank
being
you.
With
yes.
you. And from Pastor Karen, who loves all of you and an intercessor. Right now, that's her ministry calling. She can't get out. She's not as mobile, but she's definitely a prayer warrior on behalf of all of you. And, of course, Rita as well. So until next time, CCC, we love you. God bless you, and thank you for being with us today.
Yes, God bless.
Jesus is Lord, period. We believe it, we proclaim it, and we're seeing it come to pass. God bless you. I love you. Have a wonderful week in the Lord.